guys. Up and awake?
Yes.
Sure.
Sure.
Cool. So, small introduction about myself. As Alex introduced, I work with Bluehost. I have around 15 years of experience. I am a product manager by profession. A lot of the material in the talk comes from my experience being 15 years in this industry. I've been here since long, definitely. I've worked in multiple profiles, including support, system administration, and stuff. So I've been a part of the brunt that we receive from clients and stuff. So I know what goes and where are the problems, what happens. How many over here are already working or already have a website? How many have multiple websites? How many of you have never created a website? So first one, how many of you have never created a website or don't know what website is all about? So there are very few. What about people who have a few websites for their own or hobbyist or something like that? Perfect. So others, I am assuming, are professionals who actually do this for a living, have multiple websites and manage sites and stuff. So how many times have you encountered a problem that you have either overbought or underbought for your client? You haven't estimated correctly, or the customer hasn't estimated what they need correctly. How many times has that happened? Show of hands.
Many times.
It's a normal process, right? So I'll try and give you some idea on what different architectures are, what goes into trying to understand. Maybe this becomes a checklist when you go to your clients, try and make them understand what is required, even for whatever site you need. Whatever you need, do you have the stuff that you need? Are you overestimating, underestimating? And also give them an idea of how cheap or how costly a website can get depending on what they are choosing. It's just trying to make a better decision, a more knowledge decision than just going with random whatever is there. So one thing, remember, you can spend nothing, you can have a website for free, or you can think of a number and you can spend that much for your website. And it's going to run the same website without any problems. So I want everything, I want redundancy, I want to ensure it's located across the globe. You can do that, or you can just run it from your own machine and it'll still work. So just think of it clearly, what you exactly need. One size doesn't fit all. If something has worked for one website or one client, or okay, it worked for me, it may not work for you, it may not work for your business. So keep these two things in mind before trying to even start a website. So how do you choose your hosting? So what I want to cover is these four points. What is your use case? What are the general types of hosting or offered? What are caveats? The most important thing when you go to any hosting provider, the front of site page, most of that is marketing. It's not the truth out there. Everything is unlimited. Everything is free. You can do anything on the website as per that. But once you start getting into it, you understand where you hit limits, what are the problems. Everybody is there to do business. Everybody is there to make money. They can't give you the world in a penny. So remember that. And the most important bit, why choose a reliable provider? I'll cover a few items that will possibly help you out as well. Cool. So the first use case. So what should you be considering before even deciding to make a website? Forget choosing a hosting provider. What is the primary thing that you should be looking at? I would want to make this interactive, so please be open, please share. Anyone? Guys? The first thing that you have to know before making a website or starting to decide what kind of hosting I want to choose. Performance. Traffic to expect. Scalability. Uptime. Conversion focus. Okay. Excuse me. Okay. Customer support? I didn't get that. Purpose? Okay. Okay, so first is, what is the traffic expected? I want to build a Flipkart or an Amazon. Are you actually going to do that in a day, in a month? No. Don't underestimate. Okay, it's a personal site. It might not get 2-3 hits, and then you encounter that it's getting 100 visits, 200 visits a day, and your site keeps on going down. It keeps on getting slow. One thing, be cynical about what you build and iterate. Don't try to build everything on a single go. The client might want, okay, I want this, I want that, this should be here, this registration, mailers, everything should be there on the first day. Never go for that. Iterate, build as you require. This also goes into the principle of design thinking as well. Do build what is required and just don't build because you want it. Build what is needed. So I will not get more into the details of that, but think about what you are trying to build and be cynical. Client might want anything. He doesn't know everything. That doesn't mean you discount what the client wants, but use your judgment, use your experience and understand, is it actually needed? Again, don't go overboard with everything you want to do. I'll do everything at once. I'll launch an Amazon in a month. No, not possible. Uptime, somebody obviously said that uptime is obviously needed. How critical is the site? I am building my own blog site. Does it need to be up 24/7, 365 days? If there is even 15 minutes of downtime, the earth will go down? No, it won't. The more uptime, the more bells and whistles you need, you're going to pay for that. Nothing is free. Sorry guys, technical difficulties. One of the things is this a revenue generator or a hobby or information site? If it's a revenue generator, then obviously the thought behind what you need, how you need is different. If it's just a hobby site, if you're trying your first blog, if you're just interested in writing about stuff, then what you need is obviously going to be different. This is for the developers in-house. Do you need an active development environment? Do you actually need developer support? Do you need shell access? Do you need root access? Do you need those things? For the guys who don't know about it, don't fret. You don't need it. Simple as that. So, because you obviously have to pay for all of that, that all is going to cost you. What are your support requirements? One of the most critical bit. We'll cover that later. You'll know why that bit is very important. You might think you know everything. Trust me, you don't. You have no idea what it goes into keeping a hosting server up and running 365 days for years together. Again, somebody said scaling. Do you need an auto-scaling solution? Anybody who has worked with a website which has grown over the years knows how easy or how difficult it is to move from one hosting provider to another. If you have a limited hosting provider who is not able to serve above X visits, how do you then scale? You can't keep it there. If you have to move 2,000 things with all the emails and everything, it is a hassle. It's not that straightforward. So think of these terms when trying to look at these items. So now that you know what are your requirements, what do you need? What are the types of hosting in the market? Manage WordPress, straight off, okay, nice. VPS, shared hosting, reseller hosting, that's again shared. Cloud. Do you know actually what is the difference between this, or is just a word out there? Do you actually know what you are getting on the back end? What's the difference? One, if somebody says VPS, somebody says cloud, what is the difference between the two? The hardware is the same, exactly the same. Why is one called VPS, why is one called cloud? Anybody, any? Okay. Similarly, if there is any issue or there is any load failure, the cloud will go ahead. You can do it on VPS as well. So yeah, that's what I'm saying. There are very thin lines around this. So frankly, most of this is based on what is your requirement, what is your use case. Whatever you can achieve on cloud, you can achieve on VPSs and dedicateds also. I will not get into the technical details of it. There is nothing that is not achievable by shared hosting also that you can do, apart from few things that you outgrow. So let's just look at what's there. So I will just give you a brief idea of how these hosting are, what these hosting are essentially, and how do they look. Let's start with the simplest item so you understand and get an aspect of a perspective of what this hosting is all about. So the first one will be dedicated. So this essentially is supposed to be a server. I have tried to draw a server. Sorry about that if you don't find it that appealing. So it has its own CPU, own RAM. Again, I've put one site. You can host hundreds and hundreds of sites on it. But essentially, the entire CPU, entire RAM is available for that data that you have on your site. So this is dedicated hosting. Any questions on that? Now VPS. This is not the exact representation, but this is what will give you an idea what this is. So take the same dedicated box. Now you create virtual machines. So that means in your one machine, you have four sub-machines running. So that same CPU, same RAM that you are getting 100% for your site, now you have for four different machines, and that one machine can have one or multiple sites under it. This is division of a VPS. This is one subsection. This is a cloud. A little more complex, the same funda. Now, each of these blocks essentially are those same dedicated machine box. So now the only difference is the storage normally is not on the same server. So we call these as compute nodes. Compute nodes will have your CPUs and RAMs. So you'll have 7-8 arrays of CPUs and RAMs, and storage, instead of storing it on the local box, there is a big block storage of terabytes and terabytes of data, and you can allocate, let's say, CPU 1, RAM 1 for site 1, CPU and RAM, CPU 2, CPU 3, and RAM 2, RAM 3 for site 2, and accordingly. So what this does is this helps you scale. Tomorrow you want more CPU RAM, it can allocate. You want more space, you can allocate. That's a little bit of differentiation between your VPS and cloud. Most of this is connected over network. So that's when the complexity gets added. Again, the VPS that I had shown, frankly, the VPS and cloud can have this exactly the same architecture as well, because a lot of VPS companies now support private networking, scaling and stuff. You can add more space and stuff. So it is achieved by the same thing. Any questions on this? Again, representative, don't hold me to this, that there is some different architecture. There is obviously some different architecture. This is shared. So now you go to the dedicated box. But this is not as simple as a dedicated that you guys normally use or you guys buy. It might not be 16 GB or something. It might be monster servers, 128 GB RAM, 64 cores, 32 cores, CPU and stuff. And you have N number of sites hosted on that. Now these N number of sites, that means that the same CPU, same RAM can be used by one site and all site. Why is this feasible? Are all sites going to serve 100% clients or 100, do they need 100% CPU and RAM all the time? They don't, right? You will get spikes in traffic. You will get, like, at 10 o'clock in the morning, 20 people log in. 12 o'clock in the night, there is no one logging in. So there are going to be spikes, and people around the globe are getting served. So you can sustain, have more and more play on this. This is the most ventured hosting space. Most of your websites will go on this kind of infra. And there is a reason. You are dividing the cost. It's like using this. You can actually have one box for everyone and put one person in a box and give this session, or get everybody in this room and give this session. The session is going to be the same. The same concept. So now that you know these four types of hosting, manage WordPress hosting. Again, all of us here are here for WordPress. So what do you know about managed WordPress hosting? What architecture or what hardware or what layout out of the four that we discussed is used by managed WordPress hosting? Anyone? Okay. One is any of one. Others? WordPress is just a software. But what do you think, what is the architecture used? As in, I'm talking about the hosting type used for WordPress. When you say WordPress.com, that's what you're talking about, right? So what architecture does it use? Okay, one is VPS. Dedicated cloud. Exactly. That's the correct answer. So whenever you buy any of the managed WordPress hosting in the market, it can be on a VPS, on cloud, on shared, on dedicated. So when you are comparing in the market, okay, this person is giving managed WordPress, this person is giving managed. One person is giving at $10, one person is giving at $100, other one is giving at $1,000. There is a difference. They have not gone mad. They are not trying to cheat you. They are not trying to bluff out of you. Managed WordPress is going to have the same backend architecture with whatever additional layers that they put on top of it. It might be auto-scaling, auto-updating, patching. They might integrate other optimizations. They might give you free themes. They might give you free backups. There are multiple things they can do with that. And that basically forms your managed WordPress hosting. So some clarity, hopefully, it gives you what is the difference in that. So now that you know everything about, you know the requirement, you know what are the type of hosting, do you think it's that easy just still going and just buy, okay, now I know where I need to go? What are the other things that you need to consider? First, biggest rookie problem, own your domain names. You just go to the first provider, okay, buy the domain name from him and buy hosting. The time you want to move out, you face some issues, you figure out you don't even own the domain name. The registrar or the reseller from whom you bought owns the domain name. Now, trying to get your domain name back itself is a long battle. So first thing, go to a registrar, pay that extra money, own that domain name. It's okay. Paying a dollar or two extra is worth the effort. And owning it by yourself is the right decision to take. People just go to DigitalOcean, okay, $5, $500 a month. It's so cheap. Let's just go for this. If you try and manage a VPS dedicated, you'll understand what goes in managing that. VPS dedicated cloud, it's easy to say, okay, let's just host it on a cloud. It's not that simple. How many of you have used a VPS or dedicated to host your website? So once a VPS is provisioned, have you ever monitored your website or your server? What is the first thing that happens? Anyone? No, I'm not talking about getting to a website. You have just bought a VPS or a dedicated. And if you're just monitoring your server, if you actually just, have you ever checked your server, what happens on your server? Usage stats, okay. Kernel updates. Updates, upgrades, that's normal. OS thinking. Traffic. Why do you get traffic for a server that you have just procured? You have no site, no content, nothing on it. How are you getting traffic? IPs. If you actually spin up 3-4 servers, if you have ever done that, just monitor your logs. There will be login attempts starting day one. You have just got your servers online. There are login attempts. Yeah, these are old IPs, random usernames, random password. How many people try? Should you be getting 10, 15, 20, 30, 40 attempts in an hour? No, right? Do you attempt 40 times if you can't log in once? You don't, right? So you need to understand that these are open to the internet. These are not that simple. There are attacks. These are just basic attacks. You have hosted somebody's site. Maybe you have taken a dedicated server. You're like, I'll put 200 of my customers on that. Brilliant. Good move. You save a lot of money. One of the site starts getting targeted. Have you ever got DDoSed? Any of you have ever got DDoSed? You have, right? What happens? How do you control? What happens then? IP down. So all 200 guys go down. That's one. What's the other thing? Fail to ban. But how? Fail to ban? Do you think you are going to control a DDoS by fail to ban, dude? I will come to learn from you if you can do that. So, just to give you some perspective, 10 years back, a DDoS traffic of 1 Gbps, that's the network speed, was considered to be an average attack or something. Like 10, 20 Gbps was like once in a blue moon. Now, 100 Gbps attacks are normal. You can do nothing, zit, when you get a 100 Gbps attack, unless and until you have specialized equipment and services to tackle with that. For one VPS, for one dedicated, do you think you can do that? If you are hosting a critical site, some clients bread and butter, some clients e-commerce site, and that's getting DDoS because of some fourth client that's on that server. Where do you go? You can't even log in, take a backup, and dump it on your machine. You will not be able to log into your servers at all. So all those things are things you need to consider. You need to be a system admin. You need to know how to manage, how to monitor the risks that are involved in that. That doesn't mean you never look at VPSs dedicated. There are cases when VPS dedicated work. There are use cases when VPS dedicated shouldn't be considered just because they are $500 a month. They'll come and bite you back badly. If you have gone that route, you'll understand what I'm talking about. If you haven't, best of luck. Hope it doesn't happen to you. This is one of the most contested, unlimited, unmetered. What does that unlimited, unmetered mean? Can you get unlimited disk space? Can you get unmetered in $2, $3, $5, $10 a month? Can you afford it? Forget anybody else affording it. Can you afford it? Even Google will not let you do unlimited, dude. So how are you saying somebody tells you unlimited? You should rather try and ensure that you are not looking at or going to people who are giving you everything for free or everything for very cheap. It's not worth it. There are going to be limitations. If they are giving you limits front of site or telling you, okay, this is the limit, these are the number of files, these are the number of emails, this is what you'll be able to go with that provider, that's a better option. Because if you're counting on unlimited, saying I will spend $5, I will upload 20, 30, 40 terabytes of data every month and I'll live with it in $5. You can't. As in, if you're doing that, brilliant. If your provider is not noticing that, stay with that provider. People will not let you do that. Data cost, bandwidth cost, everything is a cost, right? The idea is unlimited is so that your websites will keep on working. If you are doing your normal business, your normal uptime, you'll get uptime. Your website will keep on working. You add 20, 30, 40, 50 pages tomorrow. You will not have a problem. You don't have to keep on upgrading your package for that. That's the whole concept of unlimited. Unlimited doesn't mean I'll start putting in 5 TB or 2 TB data every day and see how long it takes. It can't be a backup. So think of that very closely. There are limits. And then one of the few limits that you'll always hit is bandwidth limit. You'll always hit storage limit. You'll have number of files you can store on a server and stuff. These are basic limits that everybody has in place. It's just that they will only tell you if you cross that limit. And frankly, not in a 1% of people cross those limits, but there are people who do that. And if you have people who are crossing that limit, your server or your website starts getting slow. Because one box, everybody's sharing that. If somebody is abusing, it's coming out from your own resources, right? So it's going to affect you. Again, same point. For unmanaged VPS dedicated cloud, deal with it if you know server administration or you don't go for it. There are times when you would require VPS dedicated and stuff. If there is some critical information, proprietary information, you don't want to put it on shared. Shared, it's like using your machine with 20 other people. Somebody can look into your data. No matter what the host says, your data is visible. There are ways to go to other people's directory. It's open. If you have generic data, it shouldn't matter. But if you have confidential data, if you have banking data, card data and stuff, you'll have to go on one of those because you'll need that data separation physically and not just folder-wise. VPS dedicated does not always mean faster hosting. This is a misconception people have. You buy a 1-core, 2-core with 2 GB RAM, and the shared hosting box is literally 64 GB, 128 GB with 64 cores. Do you think it's 1:1 comparison when it comes to performance? It is not. If your requirement cycles are small, if you just need to serve 100, 200 pages an hour, frankly, your VPS is going to be much slower. On execution, you'll have to do a lot of optimizations to reach that level. So rather just go for a stock hosting and just live with that. This is one thing that can help you. Go with inbuilt caching. As in, you guys are using WordPress, so that's one thing that you should always consider. If somebody is giving you caching over and beyond your WordPress plugins, even better. Use a CDN. Save your cost. Host out of US or something that's cheaper hosting. Use a CDN to serve to your local customers. You will save a lot of money over there. You don't need to pay for those CDNs. Literally, I'll try and brief through this. Why choose a reliable vendor? Better quality infra. Simple. Invest. They are investing in better infra, better network, better data centers. Going with a tier 4 versus a tier 3 data center, there is a difference. All those things you may not understand, but when it comes to uptime guarantees, network redundancies, power redundancies, tier 4, for example, that means they need to get electricity from two different grids. So let's say if one grid is down of electricity, the other grid is powering. Have you ever considered that? So going with one of the reliable providers who can give you that, all those things are taken care of inherent. And all those come at a cost. They don't come free. Better support. If your site has ever gone down, it's got hacked, something or the other has gone down, try and connect to a support agent for any hosting provider. Look at what cheaper providers do. Look at what costly providers do. It's simple. Somebody needs to be there 24/7 in case you have a problem. If they are not available, you are doomed. If that's your business running, if you are not going to get a response for 12 hours, it's gone. You also get a lot of help and support, knowledge base articles, videos, blog articles, chats, tickets, emails. You can contact them with multiple forms. Better security. They do run, there are security scans that keep on coming in regularly, virus scans that they keep on doing. There are a lot of providers that I know of. They run their own versions and kernels of security scans and stuff. Their backups get scanned, so anything that they find is taken off and all. Free providers, free users are not going to give you that. This is again stuck, guys. Yeah, thanks. Better spam management and protection. One of the biggest problems, if you're using the free email that comes with your cPanel or something, you've always encountered this. If you don't have a good provider, are they actively preventing or looking at spam measures? Do they go and actively whitelist your blacklisted IPs and stuff? If not, you'll come to know what the problem is. You can never communicate with your domain name, email address at all. This is getting jammed, man. ...99.99% uptime guarantee. 100% nobody gives, there might be issues. Reliable backups. they have disaster recovery backups, they offer backups, they have a backup infrastructure and stuff in place. Virus malware protection is inbuilt. In the long run, in case if you by mistake get into any of those problems, you'll understand why it is going to cost you more for the free provider or for cheaper provider, because you'll have to pay for everything that you need. So in the long term, this turns out to be a lot cheaper. That's the idea. Cool, guys. I'm done. Any questions? Yeah.